Hello everyone, I welcome you all in this 8th lecture of calculus series. So far in the earlier lectures, we have understood the physical meaning of a limit followed by the criteria for existence of a limit, and later on we have also discussed different methods available with us to figure out the limit of a function at some particular point. So, in the last lecture, we particularly have discussed the algebraic method of calculating limits of a function. So, today in this session, we are going to cover an important topic, that is limits at infinity. So, firstly, we will try to understand the physical interpretation of what does limits at infinity mean, and thereafter, I will show you how to calculate limits at infinity. Many a times, as an engineer, we are more focused about finding the value of the function at some specific value of the independent variable. But this is not the case always. There are some instances where, being an engineer, we still need to figure out the behavior of the function when the value of the independent variable goes to a very, very large value or goes to a very, very small value. So, here is the application of limits at infinity. So, limits at infinity will help us in figuring out the behavior of the function when x moves to a very, very large number, or in other words, when x is tending to infinity. Or in the other case, it will help us in figuring out the behavior of the function when my x is approaching to a very, very small number, that is x tends to minus infinity. Let us try to understand these statements using the graphs. Say for example, y equals to f of x be a function of x, where x being an independent variable and y being a dependent variable. The function over here is represented on xy grid using the red line. So now let us look at the behavior of the function at a very large and large values of x. And we can see that as and when x is approaching to the infinity, the value of y is approaching to some specific value, and that value here is capital L. This basically means that as and when you feed the x, which are very, very large in values, to this function, the value of y will keep on approaching to a number capital L, and this mathematically can be represented by limit of a function f of x at x tends to infinity will be equals to capital L. This clearly means that as and when x tends to positive infinity, the value of the function f of x is approaching to capital L. On contrary, say that y equals to g of x is some another function which is defined as shown in the red curve, and we need to know that what happens to the value of the function when x is approaching to negative infinity, that means when x is approaching to a very, very small value. So, as seen here in this graph, as and when x tends to negative infinity, the value of the function y equals to g of x is approaching to the value capital M, and therefore this can be written as limit of g of x at x tends to minus infinity is equals to capital M. So, limits at infinity basically defines the end behavior of a function. That means it shows the behavior of the function at the extreme edges of your domain. You will get a better idea about limits at infinity by taking some specific example. Say for example, y equals to 1 over x. The graphical nature of y equals to 1 over x is shown here in this graph using the red lines. And let us try to figure out the value of this function when my x is moving to a very, very large number in one case, and in another case when my x is moving to a very, very small values. Let us begin with the first case. So, I just want to figure out the value of this function when x is moving to a larger and larger value. So, by nature what I will do is I will make a table where I will have two columns. First for x, second for the value of y, So I will keep on substituting the larger and larger values of x and try to see where does y approaches. Let us begin with x equals to 10. Y will be equals to 1 over 10, that is 0.1. For x equals to 100, y will be 1 upon 100, that is 0.01. For x equals to 1000, y value will be 0.001 and so on. And looking at the trend, we can clearly observe that as and when I am substituting the larger and larger values of x in the given function, the value of function itself is going to a very very small number close to 0. So in other words, we can say that as x tends to positive infinity, the value of function, that is 1 over x, tends to 0. And mathematically this can be written as limit of 1 over x at x tends to infinity will be equal to 0. So this is the limits at infinity. In particularly, I could say that this is the limit of a function 1 over x at positive infinity. Now let us try to look in the case number 2, where I want to figure out the limit of the same function but now towards the negative infinity. So again I will use a tabular form where the first column would be for x and the second column would be for y, and I will keep on substituting the smaller and smaller values of x in this function and try to figure out the value at which function approaches. So for x equals to minus 10, the value of y is minus 0.1. For x equals to minus 100, the value of y is minus 0.01. For x equals to minus 1000, the value of y is minus 0.001 and so on. Looking at the trend, it is easily observed that as and when x tends to negative infinity, the value of the function, that is 1 over x, is tending to a number 0. And therefore, limit of 1 over x at x tends to minus infinity is equals to 0. Now, whatever we have discussed about this function y equals to 1 over x, it can easily be observed from the graph as well. We could see that as and when the x is approaching to a number positive infinity, the graph is approaching closer and closer to the x-axis, which means that the value of function is moving to the 0. And on the other side, as and when x is moving to a negative value, on a negative infinity side, again the graph is approaching to the x-axis. That means again the value of function is approaching to the 0. So I hope you have got the fair idea about what does limits at infinity basically mean. Let us now calculate the limits at infinity of few functions using algebraic method. Earlier I have discussed how to calculate the limits at infinity using tabular method and graphical method. Here we will use the algebraic method to figure out the limits at infinity. So the very first example, we need to find the limit of 2 into x raised to 5 minus 5 into x raised to 3 at x tends to positive infinity. So this can be written as limit at x tends to infinity of x raised to 5 in bracket 2 minus 5 upon x square. So using the limit laws which we have already discussed in the earlier sessions, I can apply this limit separately to both these different terms. Firstly, I will apply limit to x raised to 5, and secondly I will apply the same limit to 2 minus 5 upon x square. So this limit of 2 minus 5 upon x square can again be segregated into two different terms using the limit laws, where limit of 2 at x tends to infinity minus limit of 5 upon x square at x tends to infinity. Now here we know that limit of x raised to 5 at x tends to infinity will be again infinity, because when you substitute the larger values of x and you take the fifth power of that, again you will get a very large number. So there will not be a specific number to which this value will approach, and therefore the limit of x raised to 5 at x tends to infinity is infinity. And limit of a constant function at any x will be the constant function itself. So limit of 2 at x tends to infinity will be 2. And what about this? Limit of 5 upon x square at x tends to infinity. So when you look at this expression, As in, when you keep larger and larger values of x in this equation, you would see that the value of this function itself is going closer and closer to 0. And that is why the value of this limit will be 0. And when you equate this equation, you will end up with the answer being infinity. So the limit of 2x raised to 5 minus 5x cube at x tends to positive infinity will be infinity. So here we have got the answer for the first question. Let us proceed with the example number 2. So here I have a rational function where I need to find the limit of 3x plus 5 upon 6x minus 8 at x tends to positive infinity. So at the time when you need to find the limits at infinity, particularly for the rational functions, always make it a habit that try to take out the highest power of x in the denominator. So here in the denominator I have 6x minus 8. So the highest power of x is x raised to 1. So I'll take out x common. So that will make 6 minus 8 over x. And similarly, whichever power you have taken out for x in the denominator, the same power you need to take out for the numerator as well. So again, you take x outside in the numerator, you will end up with x into 3 plus 5 by x. And then x will be cancelled out from both the sides. So you remain with limit of 3 plus 5 by x whole divided by 6 minus 8 by x at x tends to infinity. Again, this limit can be applied separately to both this numerator and denominator using the limit laws. So this will be limit of 3 plus 5 by x at x tends to infinity whole divided by limit of 6 minus 8 upon x at x tends to infinity. Again, this limit in the numerator and denominator can be applied separately to both these different terms. That is limit of 3 at x tends to infinity plus limit of 5 by x at x tends to infinity whole divided by limit of 6 at x tends to infinity minus limit of 8 by x at x tends to infinity. Now each of these limits have a particular value. So for the first, limit of a constant function 3 at x tends to infinity will be 3 itself, plus limit of 5 over x at x tends to infinity will go to 0, which we have already discussed, because x is in the denominator, and if we substitute larger and larger values of x in this function, you will end up with the values which is closer and closer to 0. So that is why limit of 5 by x at x tends to infinity is 0. Again, limit of a constant function 6 at x tends to infinity will be 6. And same for this, limit of 8 over x at x tends to infinity will go to 0. And that is how the final answer is 1 by 2. So therefore, finally we can conclude that limit of 3x plus 5 upon 6x minus 8 at x tends to positive infinity will be 1 over 2. Keep one thing in mind, that whenever you have the rational functions and you need to figure out the limits at infinity, whether it may be positive infinity or negative infinity, you just need to take out the highest power of x common from the denominator, and the same goes for the numerator, and then cancel each other. Let us try to understand the same logic using a different example, that is third one. Again, I have a rational function. Here I am supposed to find the limit of this function at x tends to negative infinity. So function given to me is 4x square minus x upon 2x cube minus 8. Here if you observe, the highest power of x in the denominator is x cube. So I would take x cube outside. So I'll remain with x cube into 2 minus 8 upon x cube. As I have taken out x cube outside from the denominator, I am also supposed to take out x cube outside from the numerator as well. So when I take x cube outside from the numerator, I will end up with x cube into 4 upon x minus 1 over x square. Cancelling out x cube from denominator and numerator, I will end up with limit of x tends to minus infinity 4 upon x minus 1 over x square whole divided by limit of 2 minus 8 over x cube at x tends to negative infinity. And again, I will use the limit laws and I will apply limits separately to each of these terms. That will make limit at x tends to negative infinity 4 upon x minus limit at x tends to negative infinity 1 over x square whole divided by limit of 2 at x tends to negative infinity minus limit of 8 upon x cube at x tends to negative infinity. And finding out the limit of each of these four terms, we know that limit of 4 over x at x tends to negative infinity will be again 0. And the same goes with limit of x tends to negative infinity 1 over x square, again 0, whole divided by limit of this constant function 2 at x tends to negative infinity will be 2, and limit of 8 over x cube at x tends to negative infinity will be 0, and therefore the final answer is 0. So limit of 4x square minus x upon 2x cube minus 8 at x tends to negative infinity is 0. Let us now proceed with the fourth example, where I am supposed to find the limit of a rational function, that is 5x raised to 4 minus x plus 2 whole divided by 2x cube minus 8 at x tends to negative infinity. Again, I have a rational function and the highest power of x in the denominator is x cube. So, I will take x cube common from numerator and denominator. This will end up with limit at x tends to negative infinity of x cube into 5x minus 1 over x square plus 2 over x cube whole divided by x cube into 2 minus 8 over x cube. Cancelling x cube from both these sides and applying the limits separately to numerator and denominator, we will get limit at x tends to negative infinity 5x minus 1 over x square plus 2 over x cube whole divided by limit at x tends to negative infinity 2 minus 8 over x cube. And again, using the limit laws, I can segregate the limit to each of these terms. I will end up with limit at x tends to negative infinity of 5x minus limit at x tends to negative infinity of 1 over x square plus limit at x tends to negative infinity of 2 over x cube whole divided by limit at x tends to negative infinity of 2 minus limit at x tends to negative infinity of 8 over x cube. And finally, we will figure out the limit of all these different terms. We know that limit at x tends to negative infinity for 5x is negative infinity. Secondly, the limit of 1 over x square at x tends to minus infinity will be 0. And again, limit at x tends to negative infinity of 2 over x cube will be 0, whole divided by limit of a constant function 2 at x tends to negative infinity will be 2 itself. And then limit of 8 over x cube at x tends to negative infinity will be 0. So finally, the entire expression will end up with the negative infinity. So that means the limit of this function given to us, which is 5x raised to 4 minus x plus 2 over 2x cube minus 8 at x tends to negative infinity will be negative infinity. So here is the answer for the fourth example. Let us now take an example of trigonometric function, that is sine x. So here in the fifth example, we are supposed to find limit at x tends to infinity for a function called sine x. Now, before I proceed further, I would just like to show you the graphical nature of the function y equal to sine x. So here I have the x-axis and y-axis, and the red curve shown to you in this graph depicts the variation of the sine x at different x. This graph will keep on varying between minus 1 to plus 1. So as and when x is moving to a larger and larger number, there is not a specific point where the function value is approaching. It is constantly oscillating in between minus 1 to 1, and therefore we cannot find a particular value of this limit for a y equal to sine x. And therefore, this kind of function does not have limits at infinity. So in particular, trigonometric functions do not have limits at infinity, and therefore limit of sine x at x tends to infinity is not defined. So by now, I hope all of you have got the fair idea about how to calculate limits at infinity for different functions using graphical method or numerical method or algebraic method. Let us summarize this session. We have started this session discussing the physical interpretation of what does limits at infinity mean, and later on we have discussed how to calculate the limits at infinity for different functions. So here we end the discussion on limits of a function. From the next lecture, we will start the topic called continuity of a function. Hope to see you again in lecture number 9. Thank you.